One of the things that I've always been inspired by when thinking about Carlo's work, and of which this university is, I know, the work of many people, but it definitely has Carlo's spirit in it insofar as it's a committed class project. It's a project that understands that actually the delights and joys of great food, particularly in Italy, have always been proletarian delights and peasant delights. And so this is not, as education has become, a temple for the upper middle class. There's a commitment here to making sure that the people who come through these doors are not just the nobility, but who are connected in some deep ways to communities around the world who are engaged in their own educational programs. I mean, the kitchen is the first place we learn. It's the first school of food, our kitchens at home where we grew up. And insofar as we can create networks of those, what we're doing is binding together rather than creating a sort of ivory tower of food. And that's what I like about here and the project of the University of Gastronomic Sciences, is that it's permeable to the fact that some of the greatest experts in anything from sort of mozzarella to tortillas may not be able to read. And when you understand that and appreciate that and celebrate that, then you end up with an understanding of education that is very different from, as I say, an ivory tower for food, and very different from sort of the cordon bleu way of thinking about food. So that's what I like about here. And what I think, I mean, every educational institution at the end of the day is a place for intellectuals to gather. And the important thing to remember when it comes to food is, again, you don't need to have a PhD to be an intellectual of food. You don't need to have a PhD to be intellectual, full stop. But particularly when it comes to food, that expertise is far more democratized and far more feminized than in other parts of the academy. And insofar as the University of Gastronomic Sciences is moving into recognizing that, that's a very exciting project for me. I think every movement and every moment has its institutions. I'm not sure it's possible to replicate what it is that's happened here. And I'm not so sure it's necessary if there are alternative spaces where people can get together over a table or in a kitchen and share. So in Detroit, for example, there's a neighborhood group called Cook, Eat, Talk, where people, it's essentially a sort of potluck, and people cook, and they eat, and they talk. They talk about the kinds of issues that they're struggling with on a block-by-block basis. And it becomes a moment for this kind of exchange, and the kind of exchange of ideas, and the exchange of seed, and exchange of recipes, but also the exchange of a certain kind of politics and an understanding that there is an intellectual life everywhere. So I definitely think that we need more organizing. I'm not sure that we need necessarily the kinds of institution that is this very, very special place. I think it's a rare privilege to have something like this, and I would be delighted if it proliferated. But there's an opportunity cost to having more than one of the University of Gastronomic Sciences. Instead, what I think is right is for it to emerge as this place did. This place emerged out of a movement that Carlo and his comrades were responsible for in the 1970s. This is where slow food needed to go. But I think other movements that are concerned with food and with justice and with equality and with the environment and with human ecology will find their places where the exchanges can happen. And insofar as we can build a network of those, I think that's the kind of globalization we can all be in favor of. Fascism has always been an ecological and gastronomic thing. And you can see that, in fact, right here in Italy, when Mussolini, one of Mussolini's slogans is that Italy must be ruralized, right? That Mussolini was out in the fields threshing particular sort of varieties of wheat that came to be understood as quintessentially Italian. And the idea of national identity and blood and soil is a sort of keystone of fascism. So fascism has always had a thing for food, and the idea of a national cuisine is both it's a confection. It needs work to make people believe that in fact this is the national cuisine, and it can be very dangerous. But I think it's important to understand that fascism is not just a cultural phenomenon, but it's always also an ecological phenomenon. It's a response to certain kinds of crisis and certain kinds of manifestations of change in the world around us. Now, that's important because some people, particularly on the left, will say, well, look, all we have to do is wait for things to get really bad, and then people will, you know, they'll come to Jesus, or you know, they'll have this moment of, oh God, this really is bad, and now we're going to make a change. Fascism is that change. Fascism is actually responding to the kinds of crisis in the soil and the crisis in employment and in reproductive labor and in ideas of how it is that humans and extra human life interact. And that's something I think that worries me a great deal, because then I'm not seeing the more comprehensive project for transformation that dreams much bigger than the Paris Agreement, right? I mean, the Paris Agreement would actually not save us, even if Trump hadn't withdrawn from it. It's a fairly milquetoast kind of agreement that doesn't guarantee in any way a survivable planet for the majority of humans 100 years from now. So what's bigger than that? Where is it that we can dream much more profound ways of responding to the state shift that we're experiencing right now? I mean, I think food has to be part of the solution. Food has the capacity to bring people together and has the capacity to, for us to be able to exchange joyfully and possibly as equals. But that gastronomy has to come with an organizing philosophy. And under fascism, the organizing philosophy is about, brave and bold men doing work in the field and then women doing the cooking and the washing up. And occasionally the hero chef will come in and then the women will do the cooking and the washing up. But if you want more transformative ways of looking at that, gastronomy has to address everything from domestic violence and household relations, gender relations, to the way that we grow food and our agroecological relationships with plants and with animals. And then our agroecological relationships with one another, and the ways that we live together in cities and towns. So these kinds of transformations I'm not seeing nearly enough of, but I am seeing them. I'm working on a project at the moment following some amazing women and men in Malawi, a project run by a group called the Soils, Food and Healthy Community Communities Initiative. I was introduced to it by a wonderful colleague of mine, Rachel Besner-Kerr at Cornell University. And she has been there since 1999 in northern Malawi, working with an amazing series of teams of farmer researchers who not only are interested in gastronomy, but they're also interested in how food is grown, and they're also interested in ending domestic violence, and they're also interested in climate change. And what's great about that is these are the organic intellectuals that I was mentioning before, people who are scientists. These aren't people who are just sort of twiddling their thumbs waiting for Jeffrey Sachs to come and give them the right answer, or whatever development expert you have. This is a story of people who are actual inquirers into their physical and their material conditions. They're interested in understanding and then changing their socio-ecological circumstances. And that means that gastronomy is definitely a part of it. They've come up with this amazing thing called recipe days, where they exchange food that is new to the community because it's certain kinds of protein or certain kinds of vegetables that are not traditional to Malawi. But they don't care about tradition. They care about making sure their kids are not malnourished, and and these forums then become spaces for ending domestic violence and for addressing climate change as well. That kind of gastronomy, the gastronomy that actually is celebrated here, is something I'm very excited about. And insofar as now the project that I'm working on has them visiting the United States, a couple of the women from northern Malawi wanted to understand why Americans weren't understanding how important climate change was. And so we met some climate change skeptics in America and really had some difficult discussions about why people believe what they believe and the structural constraints around why people believe what they believe. I think that there's a space for that kind of difficult but transformative gastronomy. But it is the kind of gastronomy that requires you and I and every man to recognize patriarchy, for example. that's not going to be easy. I mean, you know, hands up who wants to acknowledge and reject their patriarchal dividend. Well, actually, I do. And I think everyone, I mean, you know, everyone of good faith does, because equality makes everyone better off. But it's not going to be, it's not going to be sort of laughs all the way. This is hard work to recognize one's privilege and then to cast it out. But it's much better that we do that than we hang on to it, as you see with the rise of fascism. That's the other way that we think things can go. So it's a long answer to your question, but it's the most honest answer I can give, that there's, fascism is ascendant, and it offers to treat many of the things that a more comprehensive understanding of gastronomy could treat. But the fascists have more money and they have more power right now in state capitals. But there are movements across the world, like La Via Campesina, 200 million farmers, farm workers, landless laborers coming together with similar kinds of ideas and similar commitments to gender equality, for example. And that kind of gastronomy that's really committed to gender equality, that's committed to agroecology, that's committed to an end of white supremacy, end of of equality among everyone. That's the sort of thing that I'm excited about. And that I think can germinate in spaces like this. And that's what I'm excited to be discussing and learning about. So the one way you don't do it is going to someone's house and give them a lecture, right? Imagine just someone knocking at the door and saying, hey, have you thought about patriarchy today? I mean, that's unlikely to be successful. Similarly, an approach that's very much kind of one-on-one therapy is not by itself going to make change. The things you mentioned, the word norms, the way that our understandings of what belongs in certain places, the order of things, our understanding of that isn't individual, it's social, and so we have to work on changing language and meaning socially, and that's hard. But that's why I think that there's a space for collective transformation. That's why you need social movements. So part of the vision for this film production is not merely to have a film that people will be like, oh, that was a great film. That's a really amazing couple. All right, bye. You don't watch television to end patriarchy. That's not what it's for. But the way that we're envisioning this project is for different versions to be made available to groups that do organizing, everything from church groups to unions to cooperatives. And those groups will be boots on the ground committed to making these deeper changes. And that's how we support their work. So everyone from Greenpeace to the Presbyterians to the Orthodox Church to National Cooperative Grocers Association. These are the kinds of groups that we're talking to, so that we can version this film in ways that make sense to those organizations so that they can organize. Because look at me, I can't organize my way out of a paper bag. And in any case, you wouldn't want any single person coming in, with a sort of messianic message. Rather, what you need is ways where you have to organize where people are at. And so that's the answer. I mean, this is a way of getting to the question of how do you make change? You do it by organizing with groups that are already doing it. It's hard for all of us to recognize quite how much we are complicit in climate change, in part because every part of our lives renders us complicit. Everything from waking up in the morning and brushing your teeth, and the energy that's required to pump the water and to turn the light on and keep the lights running and keep the heat on, all of that has a carbon footprint. And some of us, me in particular, have a much higher carbon footprint because I fly around all over the place. To unmake oneself and to unmake the kinds of privilege that we've been sort of seduced into and rendered comfortable by is going to be very difficult. But when you think about climate change, all of us experience climate change very differently, and we experience it filtered through our position through class and through race and through gender. I mean, I'll give you an example of what climate change is. This is a story from 2010, but it gives you a sort of for instance. In 2010, there was a big fire in Russia. And Russia is one of the world's largest wheat exporters. And because the Russian government was in the teeth of the Great Recession, you remember, the governments were being shrunk, there was austerity. So they didn't have money for firefighters, and they'd clear-cut a forest. They'd sold off the forest to be clear-cut, and so there was lots of tinder on the ground. This fire got way bigger than it should have, and it threatened wheat exports. The Russian government was persuaded, possibly by some grain traders, to put an export ban. So the fire, this once in 500 years fire caused by extreme temperatures, was compounded by the sort of structures of capitalism in which we find ourselves, so that the international grain market was skewed. Some people made a ton of money in speculating on the price of grain, and all of a sudden, the grain that you needed, for example, in Mozambique for your daily bread became utterly unaffordable. And then, the government of Mozambique was also going through austerity. They didn't have enough money for plastic bullets to quell the uprising, and so they used live ammunition. And so this is a story about the government using live ammunition to shoot at protesters who are protesting the price of bread that was caused by a weather event, an extreme weather event. But I think it's important to understand that climate change is not just the weather. It's how it is that meteorology meshes with social circumstances and meshes with the socio-ecology of the planet. So when we think about, well, how do I experience climate change? How am I made by climate change? It's not just, oh shit, do I need an umbrella today? It's much more about, well, how is it that certain things are made cheap through exploitation elsewhere? How is it that my material circumstances are being influenced by the webs of trade and ecology that have been set up over the past 500 years? That's a much harder thing to get to the bottom of. But that's why climate change is the big transformation that we face ahead. But it's also why, if you're interested in transforming away from an idea of, well, we should just consume less fossil fuel and everything's going to be fine, but a more systemic approach, that's why gastronomy ends up being so important, because it's connected to not just the webs of fossil fuel consumption, but also the webs of trade and exchange and international communication that climate change is necessarily a part of.